12. Ask that you take your copy of the Word of God, turn it with me to Romans chapter 12. Look with me briefly at verses 9 through 13. Thank you, God, for that wonderful selection. I believe that should be the anthem of the Second Advent Baptist Church. Nobody told us that the road would be easy. If somebody told you that, they were a lie and the truth was not in them. But I don't believe that the Lord brought us this far. You believe that? I don't believe he brought us this far to leave us now. Sometimes my back's up against the wall. I don't know what to do. But I know one thing, God ain't brought me this far to leave me now. And can I tell you something, just a sidebar? If your hand is in God's hand, it doesn't matter how bad things may get. Because if God brought you where you are, then God is responsible for getting you out. Can I illustrate that for you? Your child is your responsibility because you have. And if you are a child of God, then God, you are God's responsibility. I don't believe God brought me this far to leave me now. Romans chapter number 12. I'm trying to let you go. I really am. But sometimes I understand what the old folks say. I'm sorry. I've been told not to say the world. My seasoned saints say.
That's all right.
God bless you. My grandfather say, you either die young or grow to be old. I'd rather grow to be old. I understand what the seasoned saints say. My soul got happy. Soul got happy. Romans chapter number 12, verses 9 through 13. I'll need to read a text, borrow about 10 minutes of the time, and we'll be on our way. Trust that everyone has it. Word of God reads like this. I love it. Let love be without hypocrisy. Abhor what is evil, cling to what is good. Be devoted to one another in brotherly love. Give preference to one another in honor, not lagging behind in diligence. Fervent in spirit, serving the Lord. Rejoicing in the hope, persevering in tribulation, devoted to prayer, contributing to the needs of the saints, practicing hospitality. Let love be without hypocrisy. Abhor what is evil, cling to what is good, be devoted to one another in brotherly love, give preference to one another in honor, not lagging behind in diligence. Fervent in spirit, serving the Lord, rejoicing in hope, persevering in tribulation, devoted to prayer, contributing to the needs of the saints, practicing hospitality. I want to preach this morning from the subject, a willing servant of Christ. You may have your seats. Thank you very much, ushers. You're certainly too kind. A willing servant of Christ. A young man by the name of Miltador was a very poor Haitian, like many Haitians. But despite the fact that Miltador was a poor Haitian, he had an upper hand on other poor Haitians because Miltador had a cow. while it may appear to both you and I that having a cow is nothing to be proud of or nothing to brag about, when you were as poor as Miltador and his family were, having a cow was like having a bank account full of money. Because despite the fact that you were too poor to purchase food, you could still receive all the proper nutrition you needed from the cow's milk. And when you needed some funds, you could allow your cow to breed with other cows. Miltador and his family didn't have much but a little hut and a cow. One day, Miltador's brother became terminally ill. And when none of their Haitian remedies were appearing to be doing any good, and when it appeared that Miltador's brother was lying on his deathbed, Miltador did the unthinkable. He went down the street to a local farm, and he sold his only cow so that his brother could see a doctor. He sold the only source of nutrition that he and his family had. He sold his only source of income that his family had because his brother needed some help. In a real instance, ladies and gentlemen, I have discovered that Miltador's action exemplifies what it means to willingly meet the needs of other people. In other words, ladies and gentlemen, meeting the needs of other people has absolutely, positively nothing to do with how much you have, neither does it have anything to do with how little you have, but it has everything to do with you using what you have to do what you can to meet the needs of other people. Therefore, the natural question that arises out of Romans chapter 12, verses 9 through 13 is, how do you willingly meet the needs of others? How do you willingly meet the needs of others? Here, in our selected text, the Holy Spirit makes known to us how it is that both you and I willingly meet the needs of other people. If, ladies and gentlemen, you are going to willingly meet the needs of other people, you must first be an authentic servant of Christ. If you are going to meet willingly the needs of other people, you must first be an authentic servant of Christ. If you're gracious with your presence on last week, then you would have heard me preach a sermon entitled The Purpose of Grace. It was inside that little sermon that the question was raised, how do you use your God-given ability? And if you took good notes, then prayerfully you understood that in order to use your God-given ability, you must first understand that the church has different God-given abilities. But despite the fact that the church has different, many different God-given abilities, ultimately, ladies and gentlemen, the church has one specific duty. And it was based on that argument that Paul eases his way into Romans chapter 12, specifically verse number 9, by encouraging each and every one of us to be who we say we are in the Lord Jesus Christ. Paul opens Romans chapter 12, verse number 9, by saying, let love be without hypocrisy. The word love that Paul uses here in the text is the Greek word agape. It refers to sacrifice. sacrificial love. It refers to that kind of love that looks beyond a person's faults and sees what a person needs. It refers to that kind of love that God has for both you and I. Thought I'd have a witness there. Glad from my home. Gospel according to John chapter 3, somewhere around verse 16, Jesus proclaims the heart of how we are expected to love other people. In John 3:16, Jesus proclaims there that for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him shall not perish but have everlasting life. Did you get it? God gave. Not because God needed anything, but because both you and I needed something. God supplied our needs, and it is up to us. God expects us to supply the needs of one another. But how should you love? Paul answers. Paul says you ought to love without hypocrisy. The word hypocrisy here means to pretend to be something that you are not. The Greek word has the picture of an actor. The term was generally found in theaters, where someone would be hired to pretend to be something that they are not. But generally, a person who was interested in acting, they were only interested in acting, hear me, because they enjoy the applause at the end of the show. Y'all ain't listening. Let me see if I can wake you up. Generally speaking, a person who entered the field of acting was not so much because they enjoyed being someone else, but they entered the field of acting because at the end of the show, when they took a bow for putting on this Oscar performance, they enjoyed when people threw flowers at their feet. They enjoyed when people stood up and gave them a standing ovation. So if I need to pretend to be what I'm not in order to get what I want, then so be it. Paul says that is not the kind of love that should take place inside the church. You should not pretend to love me just because of what you can get out of me. You should love me because you are a servant of the Lord Jesus Christ. And what servants of the Lord Jesus Christ do, they love, Paul says, without hypocrisy. They don't pretend to be what they are not to get the applause at the end of the show. This 21st century church changed me many times, because when you don't call a person's name for doing what they were supposed to do in the first place, they get upset with you. That is loving with hypocrisy. Paul says, you ought to love without hypocrisy. Can I give you the 411 on being a Christian? Sometimes your deeds, your good deeds, will go unnoticed. When was the last time you saw somebody on the 6 o'clock news for doing something good? No, every time you see something, it's about somebody doing something bad, because your good deeds will oftentimes get overlooked. And if you have hypocrisy inside of your heart, when somebody overlooks your good deeds, you get mad. Paul says, if you are going to willingly meet the needs of other people, you must be an authentic servant of God. Not a fake servant of God, not a sinner dressed up in Christian clothing. You must be an authentic servant of God. Paul, in Philippians chapter 2, somewhere around verse number 3, Paul offers us the requirements of an authentic believer. Paul says, do nothing from selfishness or empty conceit, but with humility of mind, regard one another as more important than yourself. An authentic servant of Christ does not say, I'm better than you, so you should be serving me. An authentic servant of Christ sees a need and is willing to meet the need. If you're taking notes, that is a good place to jot something down. An authentic servant of Christ sees a need, and without hesitation, they meet the need that they see, despite who the person is. If you are going to willingly meet the needs of others, you must be an authentic servant of Christ. Secondly, if you are going to willingly meet the needs of others, not only must you be an authentic servant of Christ, but you must respect other authentic servants of Christ. First, you have to be an authentic servant of Christ before you can respect an authentic servant of Christ. If you are not an authentic servant yourself, then you cannot respect an authentic servant. Verses 10 and 11, Paul encourages us to willingly respect other authentic servants of Christ. Paul says, be devoted to one another in brotherly love, giving preference to one another in honor. Paul, how do I respect other authentic servants of Christ? Paul says, simple, just devote yourself to brotherly love.
All right.
Word brotherly love here in the text comes from the Greek word philadelphia. That's where we get our English word Philadelphia from, the city of brotherly love. Paul's exhortation here is to love one another as sisters and brothers. Paul's exhortation here is to love one another as people from the same mountain.
All right.
Paul exhorts us here to have family love. Paul says, devote yourself to brotherly love. In a utopian family, which is a fancy way of saying in a perfect family, brothers and sisters get along without any problem. Why? Because despite the fact that some may be tall and some may be short, despite the fact that some may have education and some may not have education, despite the fact that some may be doing good financially and some may be doing poorly financially, in a perfect family, everybody still gets along, because despite their many differences, they realize that they have one thing in common. We all came from the same place. Oh, have mercy. Inside the church, ladies and gentlemen, I don't care how financially stable you are. I don't care how economically fortunate you are. I don't care how much education you have. The fact of the matter is, if you are in the body of Christ, we all have one thing in common. We are all sinners in desperate need of a Savior. And that's what brings us together, to devote ourselves to brotherly love. I never known a sinner who looked down on another sinner. Growing up in my household, Aunt Sean, Aunt Chris, Aunt Ross, and Tisha was wherever she was. But we all got along. Chris was athletic. Sean was talented in music. I was just bad. But we all got along. You know why we all got along? Because we had one thing in common. That lady who got to stay in the big room.
All right.
We all came from her.
Okay.
And at any time that she saw us thinking that we were better than one another, she quickly let us know, I love all my kids the same. You all came from me. You are a servant of Christ. I am a servant of Christ. The fact of the matter is, we are servants of Christ. You may be the cup bearer. I may be the one who washes feet. Somebody may be the one who opens the door. But the fact of the matter is, ladies and gentlemen, we are all servants of Christ. Paul says, have brotherly love. Devote yourself to brotherly love. But he extends his exhortation. He extends his encouragement by saying, give preference to one another in honor. The word honor here is a very technical term. It simply means to view another servant as better than yourself. When I look at you and I pay homage to you as somebody who is better than me, and you look at me and you pay homage to me as somebody who's better, we cancel everything else out. Paul says, give preference to one another. Don't say, I'm the only one can do that, and if I don't do it, then it can't be done. Amen. Paul says, give preference to one another in honor. Look at others as being more useful than yourself. But when you look at people and all you see is uselessness, there can be no brotherly love. No, you may not be able to do what I can do, but guess what? You are able to do something. And that something that you are able to do is just as important as what I am able to do. And when you do what you are designed to do, and I do what I am designed to do, we can have a hallelujah good time. When we devote ourselves to brotherly love by saying, without you, I am nothing. And you saying to me, without you, then I am nothing. But when you look at other people and say, I can do bad all by myself, that's exactly what you're going to do. Bad all by yourself. I ain't expecting amens this morning, but we all right. All right, we good. Don't worry about that. Paul says, you have to respect if you are going to willingly meet the needs of others. You have to respect other authentic servants of Christ. Not only if you're going to willingly meet you're going to willingly meet the needs of others, not only must you be an authentic servant of Christ, Not only must you respect other authentic servants of Christ, but lastly, and I'm going to get out these wet clothes, you must remember that Jesus is coming back. Did you hear me? Not only must you be an authentic servant, not only must you be a real servant, not only must you respect other authentic servants, not only must you respect other real servants, but you must remember that Jesus is coming back. I didn't make that up, just in your Bible. Verses 12 and 13, Paul attempts to motivate us to willingly meet the needs of others on the grounds that Jesus is coming back. Do you see it? No? Let me show it to you. Paul opens verse number 12 by simply saying, rejoice in hope. Phrase rejoice in hope there simply means to celebrate the certainty of the future. The hope of the Christian believer is that Jesus Christ is coming back, and he's coming back for a church that does not have a spot or a wrinkle. Translation: Jesus is coming back for a church that is doing what he has called it to do. Meet the needs of other people. Paul says, the motivation or what should motivate you to be an authentic servant, what should motivate you to respect other authentic servants is the fact that someday you are expecting Christ to make his return. And when Christ makes his return, he wants to see servants who were doing their job in his absence. I didn't plan on saying this, but it just jumped in my heart, so I'm going to say it. You know what me and my brothers used to do when my mother would leave? I'm going to tell y'all, but y'all don't tell her. We used to play basketball, but we didn't have a goal. But the chairs in the kitchen, we would unscrew the top. We would hang the chair. Don't tell my mama, I'm telling y'all this now. She'll come back and whoop me. We'll hang the chair on the wall. And you know what we used to do for us to tell that the time was up, the game was over? We used to go in the washing room and turn on the dryer. Don't tell hubby. And we would wait for the dryer to count down. Mama, before she believes, she'd say, Sean, you need to do this. Clement, you need to do this. Chris, you need to do this. But we would spend all our time doing what we wanted to do. And when we heard that car pulled up, everybody knew what they were supposed to do. Cut the dryer off, put the lid back on the chair. Act like you got some sense. And when we thought we was cool, that mama didn't catch us doing what we were doing. But what made mama mad was not that we were doing what we were not supposed to be doing. What made her mad is that we had not done what she told us to do. Christ is coming back, and what is going to upset him is not necessarily finding you doing whatever you're doing. But what will upset him is when he finds you not doing what he told you to do.
Alright.
What did he tell us to do? Paul says he told us to meet the needs of others. Who are the others? Brother, Reverend, Pastor, Preacher, you
you keep saying, to meet the needs of others. But who are the others? Are they believers? Are they non-believers? Who are they? Paul says that they're both. Paul says, I didn't make this up, it's in your Bible. Rejoicing in the hope, persevering in tribulation, devoted to prayer, contributing to the needs of the saints. That's believers. But then Paul says, practicing hospitality, that's non-believers. You know how you win a non-believer? Paul tells you here, you practice hospitality. Let me clarify something here for those of you who attended Wednesdays in the Word this past Wednesday, and John makes a statement there in 2 John. He says, don't help anyone. He's not referring there in John to non-believers. He's referring to people who have the spirit of the Antichrist. People who come into the church and cause confusion. Paul, John said, don't help them. Paul is not speaking about those people. Paul is speaking about those people that they don't try to start confusing in your church. You just got to win them to Christ. And how do you win them? You practice hospitality. How do I practice hospitality? Paul says the same hope that allows you to persevere in tribulation, the same hope that allows you to continuously pray to God, the same hope that allows you to contribute to the needs of other believers is the same hope that should motivate you to practice hospitality. The word hospitality here simply refers to strangers, people you do not know. This is interesting because we don't have a problem showing hospitality to strangers, do we? Because when we meet a stranger, we want the stranger to think that we are something we're not. I have a problem showing hospitality to people I know. When you know too much about a person, you have this sense of this urgency that you don't need to do nothing for that person. I know that. Paul says, Jesus has called us to meet the needs of others, to meet the needs of believers, and to meet the needs of unbelievers. Paul, Jesus says, by this will man know that you are my disciples. All right. Can I tell you what I consider to be one of the saddest passages of scripture in the Bible? It starts off to be very sad, but it ends up to be very joyous. Matthew chapter 25, particularly verses 34 through 40. The context of the passage says that Jesus will come back. Yes, he will. And when he comes back, he will separate the sheep from the goat. He'll put the sheep on his right hand. He'll put the goat on his left hand. And to the goat, he'll say, depart from me, thou worker of iniquity. That's the saddest passage I consider to be in the Bible. But here is where it gets joyous. Jesus says, those on his right hand side, he'll say, enter into the kingdom that was prepared for you from the foundation of the world. Why, Jesus? Because when I was hungry, you fed me. When I was thirsty, you gave me drink. When I was naked, you clothed me. When I was in prison, you came to visit me. is that if you are going to willingly meet the needs of others, you must be an authentic servant of Christ. Not only must you be an authentic servant of Christ, you must respect other authentic servants of Christ, all while remembering that Jesus is coming back. You remember that poor Haitian boy named Miltador, whose prized possession was a cow. Miltador willingly sacrificed his cow to make sure his brother would be all right. God willingly sacrificed his son to make sure you and I would be all right. My question to you is, what are you sacrificing to make sure somebody else will be all right? I'm giving God any praise for the prayer. Doors of the church are open.